Hello and welcome to my talk. I am Marlene Rudolph. I'm a UX designer from Mainz, and I work in Wiesbaden right now at an agency called Ginkgo. We are an agency for digital communication, and yeah, I do web design, app design, testing, and project management. Like Oliver said, I was here 2 years ago at Dynamic Font Day, and I was very deep in the research of my master's thesis back then. And today I want to speak about the outcomes and the findings of my work. Yeah, in the field of typography in the Internet of Things. And I called my talk From Responsive to Life. I hope in the end you will see why. But first, I have a few numbers for you. Here is a visualization of how many people we are right now on this earth. We are around 7.6 billion humans on this earth. Here you can see the growth of the world population since 2003. And for those of you with good eyes, yes, the black squares get bigger on the right side. Now I will show you the population of the connected devices on this earth. In 2003, there were 0.5 billion connected devices. We as humans still had the majority. But in 2008, the tables turned and the connected devices overruled us as humans. Already in 2010, there were 12.5 billion connected devices on this earth. This is how it looks today. And this is how it will look in 2025. Quite impressive, I think. And when I saw this chart for the first time, it struck me and I thought, wow, this is really huge. And it only keeps growing. So yeah, the Internet of Things is a very big part of our lives right now, and it will also be in the future. Mostly, we don't notice the connected devices around us, they simply become a part of our daily lives, and mostly their goal is to remain invisible. They simply do what they do and they stay in the background. But when we take a closer look, we can already see lots of smart devices in our homes and all around us. The most obvious are smart lights. More and more people I know do have smart lighting in their room, in their homes. But what else do we think about when we think about the Internet of Things? Maybe you think about washing machines, heating devices, smart coffee makers, smart fridges, or so on. And most of these devices function without text at all. The light turns on when I say, "Hey Siri, turn the lights on." The heating devices turn itself on and off automatically, or the shutters go up and down with the sunlight. So there's no text at all. Lots of smart devices are connected to each other and automatically work in the background, like I said. They do what they do, and they do not necessarily have to interact with us as the user anymore. And this interaction could be something you would need text for. So one of the big questions of my project was, when the Internet of Things gets that important in the future, and when it mostly does not use text at all, what is the future of typography? Does it even play a role in the Internet of Things? And if it does, where could typography be found in the Internet of Things, and what new challenges could be there that typography has to master? I started my research with looking at different kinds of Internet of Things applications because I wanted to know which of them use text, and if they use text, where. Lots of Internet of Things applications do not use visual interfaces. They use gesture control or voice control, and that is very exciting right now. Everybody wants to have it, and because it's relatively new. And for a lot of situations, that's very useful, I think. For example, you can easily put the music on hold or the TV or asking Alexa a quick question. But imagine yourself sitting in a train fully packed with people or a bus. Do you want to sit there with all these people around you and say, "Hey Siri, when's my next doctor's appointment?" Or, "Hey Siri, how is my heart rate?" Or, do you want to walk across the street and gesture in very funny ways? I don't think so. So, in some situations, interfaces with text will remain the best way to communicate. Because interfaces with text have some very convincing advantages. They are very clear at first. They are clear and distinct, and misunderstandings are very rare. It also communicates silently with the user, so no one gets disturbed or involved. And because it's silent, for me the biggest part is it's private. We will always have to deal with sensitive information about us or about others, and we don't want everybody around us to know what we do with this sensitive information. And because of that, I believe, yes, text has to remain an important part of interfaces in the future. And therefore, it also will, text will be there in the Internet of Things. I now want to show you some examples of where it is used and, yeah, how. Mostly smart devices are installed and operated through an app. An example for that could be Philips Hue, the smart lights. You maybe know Philips Hue. Yeah. Yeah, at first they can be used like regular lights. You simply plug them in and can turn them on and off like regular lights. But if you want to set colors or timers, you have to use the app. And through this app, your lights become smart. Yeah, so there's use of typography in apps in the Internet of Things, but there are plenty of others that can talk about typography in apps better than me. And yeah, it's basically an old thing and we know what we do there. But for the Internet of Things, there are plenty of other devices and situations where the use of typography is not that easy. For the Internet of Things, devices get more and more specific. These gadgets are fully packed with sensors and have very special displays and therefore have very special interfaces. And examples for that are wearables like smartwatches or smart home devices with temperature sensors or smart glasses. To get fonts on these devices is not that easy as it sounds in the first place, because often the displays are very small and they have very poor resolution. And these devices have very poor processing power and very few memory. But in the Internet of Things, they are at least normal displays. For the Internet of Things, there might be tons of other possible interfaces that are even worse. These displays or non-displays could be foldable displays or interfaces on glass, like we see it all the times in futuristic movies like Iron Man, or they could even be projected on a wall or in human arm, like shown here. And all of these challenge typography even more. To remain readable, for example, on a projection on glass, there has to be lots of user testing and lots of work for the text and the whole interface to remain readable. Yeah, and it's nearly impossible to deal with one static solution and one static interface with all of these complex environments. So, yeah, these could be the places where text is used in the Internet of Things. And I already talked about some challenges, but what other challenges could there be in the Internet of Things that type has to deal with? I went on with my research and asked this question, what about the challenges, to some experts. Here's an overview of my experts. I had web type experts, IoT experts, a type designer, and a variable fonts expert. Some of them are also here today, so thanks again for your help. And some of them were already experimenting in the Internet of Things sector. Frank Rausch, for example, designed interfaces for head-up displays in cars with his students. He said, "Designing for head-up displays is nothing like traditional display typography." They found out that it is extremely difficult to find the right fonts and the right styles for head-up displays because obviously the background changes all the time when you sit in the car behind your windows. Dominik Witzke, who worked at IXDS here in Munich back then, had experience in designing interfaces for smart washing machines and fridges. He told me that in his work, one of the big challenges is the language, because every language has different long words, and it is very hard to design one single interface on a small display for more than one language, because you simply cannot use the space very good when it's small. He said, "It is very difficult to design interfaces for products that are sold worldwide." So mostly it is the case that every language gets a completely unique interface for the Internet of Things. And even when it's the same product, it gets a unique interface because you can deal with the language better then. This was also something Jason Pimentel told me. He said, "The same fridge in different countries is a completely different product." I also talked with Felix Braden, who then had recently brought out his font Tuna, which is optimized for readability on screens. And he said to me that it is not an important and insolvable task to find the right typography for a distinct medium, even when it's a very small one. And because typographers have always adjusted to a new medium and always will find a specific solution. But the current development is that the designer does not know exactly for which medium he designs anymore. And that was something I found very important, because for the Internet of Things, designers have to give up the control a little bit and more design the system behind the layout instead of the layout itself. Tim agreed with Felix and said, when on a small display, only very little information can be shown, typography has to search new solutions. And as we all know, typography did. One of the key moments of my master's research was when I was in Warsaw for iTypeHigh, only 2 years ago, and I was unsuspectingly sitting in the audience when variable fonts were presented. I immediately thought, wow, what a cool technology. And for the first time, not only the layout can be responsive, but the font itself. Variable fonts do not only have an enormous impact on web and print typography, but also for typography in the Internet of Things, I think. And I guess every one of you knows what variable fonts are, but for recap, you can interpolate live between certain design axes. You can use one at the same time or even more design axes. And in total, there are 64,000 design axes. That is such a big number. None of us can comprehend that right now. There are lots of very cool projects that experiment with width and X height and optical sizes, for example. And I envy every one of the people who design and for and with variable fonts. They do a really awesome job, and I know that there are some very interesting projects that will be shown later today. But these are only the most obvious design axes, and I believe when we think about the Internet of Things, there could be more. I believe there are thousands of design axes we don't know yet, and for the Internet of Things, more design axes should and will come. One example is that a font could react on the language that is used in an interface. Here you see an example I developed in my master's project. I called it the variable font step counter, and you see it in German on the left and in English on the right side. And the German word Schritte is much longer than the English word steps. So when you change the language of this imaginable step counter, the variable font in this interface could react on the language. For the long word, it could get narrower, and for the short word, it could get wider. The font would be the same, but it interpolates when you change the language, and it makes the most of the space that there is. Variable fonts could also help in means of corporate identity. Often a company has a website and an app, and it's usual to have the same font on these two devices. To keep simply the corporate design consistent. But when an IoT application gets developed, like a fridge, for example, it's most of the time not possible to use the same font as on the other two because it's not readable. And I think with variable fonts developed a little bit further, you could use one font for all and let the font itself react on the display it's displayed on. So a font could adapt itself on some circumstances it is in. And what would be if it could react on all other kinds of parameters? The one thing, like I said before, the one thing that is special for IoT applications is that they are full of sensors, and often they have cameras, motion sensors, facial recognition systems, and so many more. And so because of all these sensors, the system knows exactly what goes on around it and in its environment. And the interface and the font could use that and react on it. That would make the font not only responsive, but also alive. And that is what I would call live fonts. Live fonts could be variable fonts that react on external parameters. And that could solve the problem that we don't know what we are designing for and can help the designer design the system behind the layout. External circumstances could be the lighting, the reading distance, the color of the walls, the time, and so on. And you only would have to design one solution with one font, and the interface could adapt itself to what the situation it is in. And I want to point out that sure, with all of that, it's sure to that a type designer has to come up with ideas how to transform the font and which axes to combine. But yeah, I think it could be possible. And these two examples I showed are only with the design axes we know right now. But I can imagine so many more, like I said. One example could be an axis for interfaces projected on shop walls. A font could react on the pedestrian, maybe the weather, the time, the color of the room, or the lighting of the room behind it, and all what you can imagine. And in my thesis, I developed some sketches to illustrate some of the possibilities. Here we have a projection of a menu in a restaurant, and yeah, the interface could react on the guest having glasses or not, the color of the table, the lighting in the room, and so on. In a museum, for example, the description could adapt on where the user stands or his or her age. And maybe it could reveal some more information for the older lady right here. A smart poster, for example, could reveal its content when the pedestrian gets closer and closer and gets more, the font could get more clear. An interface could become even accessible with these live fonts. For example, the display of the fridge and the font on it could get bigger when my grandma, who left her glasses in the other room, sends here. Yeah, you see, there is lots of potential for typography in the Internet of Things, and variable fonts could make that a lot easier. And some of the challenges I talked about, for example, that we don't know what we're designing for, the unknown medium, like I called it, or the small displays, can be solved with them. And the language problem also. And for sure, it's not that easy to design, to develop, to even think about these complex interfaces. But there has to be user testing. Maybe even new test environments have to be developed. But I believe it's worth it. And I think we have to have more interdisciplinary teams in the future for that. So typographers, developers, and designers have to work closely together. But it's worth it, and it's simply more efficient. You can design one interface that adapts itself fluidly on all different kinds of mediums, and so in the end, it's totally device independent. In total, I want to point out what is possible with typography in the Internet of Things, and maybe can make you some appetite for making projects in this field. And I think for the Internet of Things, typography does not only have to become responsive, but also live. Thank you very much.